It is a blessing and a delight to see you here today. If you're still out in the hallway, please come on in and find a seat as quickly as you can. And let me take this time to make a few announcements. So this is that time of year when we have a number of announcements. Let me start with today we will be receiving communion together. And if you have not already gotten your communion cup kit, go ahead and get it there from by the sound booth and camera. And feel free to just move now and grab those. Also, this week, we are starting our Awana ministry, relaunching after a year of modified Awana. We are looking forward to starting that this week at 6:30 on Wednesday evening. There are a handful of these flyers still available. And if you know of a young child, really from the eighth grade and down to kindergarten, you would be welcome to invite them to come, even come with them to help them get settled if you would like to. But you can share that with neighbor kids or grandkids or whoever. We're looking forward to getting that going starting this Wednesday. Also, let me mention the benevolence offering for today. So ordinarily on the first Sunday of the month, we receive a benevolence offering. And today it is designated for all of the young people who are traveling with Life Action. By the way, they're leaving this week to head off to their various ministry locations after their summer of training. So this money that is collected will go towards Andrew Orsag, Hannah Orsag, and Mark Fitzhenry. Let me also mention men's Bible study. So today really is the last day to sign up for men's Bible study, either on probably on Monday or Tuesday. I will be ordering the books. So if you call me tomorrow morning, you can still get a book. I would love to have as many of you men who are willing to study this book with us, The Godly Man's Picture by Thomas Watson. That would be a blessing to all of you men. And then women's Bible study, you have a little more time to do the sign-up, so you can sign up for women's Bible study until September the 19th, and that will be a video study with a book by Jackie Hill Perry on the book of Jude, the biblical book of Jude. So I want to encourage our ladies to be a part of that Tuesday morning Bible study, Tuesday mornings at 10 a.m., starting on September the 28th. And then finally, there are some Operation Christmas Child work days this week on Tuesday, and then next week on Monday. The details are there in the bulletin. Men and women are welcome to come and help with those. There are a couple of different times as a part of those two different days, but two work days for this month, September the 7th and September the 13th for Operation Christmas Child. And by the way, if you don't know what they do, they package things and unpackage things and get them all prepped and ready so that we can send out another record number of gift boxes to children around the world that goes out with a Bible study and ministry helps and serves children all around the world. Well, this is the Lord's Day, and it is our great privilege and responsibility on this day to worship Jesus Christ as our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer, and then we'll read Scripture together. Dear Heavenly Father, we simply come before you and we acknowledge our own neediness. We need to hear from your word today. We need to depend upon you in prayer. We need fellowship with one another. We need to worship you. We need to bring the praises of our hearts to you to worship the living God. And I pray, O God, that you would draw our hearts near to you as we read Scripture and as we sing and as we pray. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, if you would, please turn your attention to the screen. And stand with me as we read together from Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Remain standing as the worship team comes and leads us, and our first song is My Heart is Filled with Gratefulness. Thankfulness.
We'll give Rosalie a second to come back up here. All right, let's sing together. Ready?
One, two, three, four.
Us in prayer, I want to mention that the offering plates are in the back of the church, or if you wish to give online at cbcdemotte.com, you may do that, as well as if you wish to mail it here to the church at 814 North Halleck, you may do that. Let's pray. Our Father, I think about how it's because you are rich in mercy and because of the great love with which you've loved us that we have been made alive together with Christ, that you have made us yours, and that you have begun us on our own journeys of discipleship to walk with you, to grow with you, to participate in discipling others as well. Thank you that we could assemble here today and sing of your mercy and grace and love and express our thankfulness for all that you've done for us. I want to pray in particular this morning. We want to pray together, Father, for those who are setting out on this year's journey with Life Action Ministries for the Silver Team that Mark and Hannah are traveling on, as well as the Life Action Red Team that Andrew is traveling on. We thank you for them, Father. We thank you that they are where they are. And I'm just thankful that they get to participate in a ministry of encouraging others and bringing others to you, as well as helping others grow in you through the various roles that they play. And I just pray you will use them, Father. I pray that they will be abundantly fruitful this coming year and that you would also work in them through this opportunity, and pray that they'll know that our hearts are with them. I also want to pray for the launch of this year's Awana program. I thank you that the opportunity to be restored to a more normal style of meeting is before us, and I pray, Father, that you would keep that door open. And I pray, Father, that you would bring those that you desire to be here, that they will be touched by you, that you will bring children to belief in you, as well as to grow in grace and in their knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May that be so. Bless the workers there. Help them to just have a sense of serving in your strength and sharing your words. And Father, we pray for ourselves as well, that we will continue to grow in grace, to understand the richness of your mercy, the greatness of your love. You'll pray you'll use this time together for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I mean, we do serve a God who is merciful and gracious to us and who has loved us with a great love. And so many of the songs that we sing are really about that. So go ahead and stand with us, and we're going to sing about that, the mercy and the grace with which God has loved us.
Amen.
These are the words of the psalmist from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than the watchman for the morning, more than the watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities.
Let's sing together, Out of the Depths.
Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness makes my gaze. I sin redeemed by grace alone. I will wait for you, I will wait for you. On your word I will rely, I will wait for you. Surely wait for you, till my soul is satisfied. So put your hope in God alone. Take courage in his power to save, completely and forever won, by Christ emerging.
God himself has paid the price, that all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice. That all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice.
We sing that out, I will wait.
I will wait.
Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Oh, dear Lord, we pray that you would help our souls to be satisfied. Help us to rely upon your word, to trust in Jesus, and find the grace and peace that we need in him. Lord, may it be that we would rest in you today, that as we open your word and as we hear the preaching of your word, that both my act of preaching and the congregation's act of listening would be an act of faith and of resting in you and saying, yes, we want to know what God has said. And we want to follow and obey and believe and trust in that. Lord, may it be that you would draw us near to you through your word during this time. Lord, we also want to pray for some specific needs, both in our congregation and in our kind of acquaintance. Lord, at least one of our members is facing a serious bout of COVID, and then an acquaintance of one of our church members as well has been put in the hospital because of COVID. And we pray, oh God, that you would give them healing, strength, and comfort as they battle this virus. I pray, oh God, that you would be with Luann especially, and with Dean especially as well. Lord, we also want to pray for one of our missionary organizations, the Baptist Children's Home. They have been facing ongoing challenges and setbacks, and I pray, oh God, that you would just minister to them as they face problems and also as they look to the future with vision and with the need to kind of retool the way that they do ministry to families and children in crisis. I pray that you would minister to them and help them through a time of transition and difficulty. Lord, we've invested much in their ministry, years and years of summer missions trips and also missionary giving. Lord, I just pray that you would take that investment and use it for your glory and help the Baptist Children's Home. Lord, we also want to ask that you would help us as your people in this community. Help us, Lord, to represent you well, to have lives that reflect your character and reflect your glory. Help us, Lord, to speak the truth of the gospel, the love of the Lord, the sacrifice of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Help us to speak these things in love and grace and in boldness in our community, in our neighborhoods, in our schools and jobs. Give us opportunities, Lord, to have spiritual conversations with people, and use us, Lord, to encourage others and bring them to the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray again that you would open up your word to our hearts in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, it's been quite some time since I have said this, but nevertheless, boys and girls, second grade and down, you can be dismissed to go to your classes at this time. Thank you for being with us so far in our time of worship. And for the rest of us, if you would, please turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. And as you're turning, let me start off with a question. And once again, we can maybe make this an interactive question. How many of you like to snack? Snacking is one of your things, right? Yes, I'm a professional snacker myself, right? So just go ahead and tell me, what's your favorite snack? Anybody want to speak up and tell me? Pizza, Hope, Kit Kat Duos. Marley, candy in general. Brad, chocolate-covered cashews. I've seen Brad go through an entire bag of those in the deacon's meeting. I don't know if it was his appetite or the length of the meeting. Maybe that was supper, too. But yes, go ahead. Oh, Albanese. Oh, my goodness. The world doesn't know Northwest Indiana's best-kept secret is Albanese candy, right? That's good stuff. Tyler? Fruit snacks. Yeah, I like gummies. Go ahead, Hudson. Cereal. Oh, my goodness. The grocery bill in general has gone up since Hudson moved home. But the cereal part of that bill has gone up exponentially. That's right. There's going to be a surcharge pretty soon. Anybody else? Go ahead. Chips? Ramen noodles. Oh, okay. I'll let you have your ramen noodles. In fact, you can have mine. Lance, and then we'll end. Don't forget Klondike bars. Yes, ice cream. I would say my favorite snack is definitely ice cream. So, well, let me say it this way. The book of Romans is not a spiritual snack. It is a seven-course meal. It is Paul the Apostle's longest book with 16 chapters, but even if you count out the Greek words, it's the longest book or the longest letter that he wrote. And verses 1 through 7 are his longest greeting. But we are going to try to digest a little bit of this first chapter, Romans chapter 1, verses 1 to 7. And we're going to do kind of a little appetizer for our sermon this morning, especially for this introduction. So we're going to do some questions, and these are in your notes there if you've got a copy of the bulletin. I'm afraid we ran out today, but nevertheless, for those of you who do have a copy of the bulletin, you can follow along and fill in some blanks here. Who did Paul write the letter of Romans to? Well, he wrote it to believers. He wrote it to the believers who were in Rome. And he wrote it, and this is important, to the believers who were both Jewish and Gentile. They were both Jewish and Gentile believers in the church at Rome at this time. Why did Paul write the letter to the Romans? Well, first of all, he wrote it to encourage unity. He wrote it to encourage unity in the church of Rome, specifically unity between the Jewish and the Gentile believers. So I am going to take a little bit of a nerd path here for a second. So just so that you can know a little tidbit of the background, the best scholars that have studied both the history of the Roman Empire, the history of the Christian church, and the book of Romans itself, including some passages from the book of Acts as well, they have almost certainly determined that the book of Romans was written sometime between 54 and 57 AD, and that part of what Paul is trying to accomplish is rebuild some unity because there had been an event. An event had happened that kind of brought some feelings of disunity or not really a schism, but some problems in the church at Rome. And the event was that in AD 49, the Emperor Claudius kicked all the Jewish people out of the city of Rome. And it was most likely because they were arguing over the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. And they were causing quite a bit of turmoil. And so he wasn't going to decide, which ones of these are Jewish and which ones of these are Jewish Christians and what's the problem here. He just said, all of you, you're kicked out. They were banished from the city of Rome. So all Jewish people, Christian or not, had to leave the city of Rome in about 49 AD. And then Claudius died in 54 AD, and Nero took over. We all are familiar with the Emperor Nero. And he allowed the Jewish people to return. Either he allowed them to return, or simply their banishment expired with the death of Claudius, the emperor. And what had happened in the meantime, so all of the Jewish Christian founders of the Church of Rome had to leave. And they left the church in the hands of Gentile believers. And then the church really grew. And then all of the founding Jewish believers returned. And in the space of 5 years or so, things had changed. And there were some cultural tensions that resulted from this previously being a primarily Jewish church with some Gentile believers, and now it's a primarily Gentile church with some Jewish believers. So you can imagine what that might be like if you were Jewish and, there was never any ham at the potluck, and everybody kind of talked the same and dressed the same and had similar background, and then all of a sudden you have to leave. When you do come back, just the cultural feeling of the church would have radically changed. And it would have been tense. It would have been like, this doesn't quite feel like home any longer. And so he's writing this book to help rebuild that unity. It takes him a long time to get to the specific Jewish-Gentile issues, but nevertheless, part of what he's doing is trying to help them mend some of those tensions that they were feeling. And then the second reason that Paul is writing this book is to recruit the church at Rome to support his mission to Spain. So he has intentions to go to Spain on a mission endeavor. And he is planning, he expresses these plans, but he is planning to go first to Jerusalem, and he is going to deliver the financial collection that he has got for them. Then he is going to go to Rome, where he's never been yet, and he wants them to send him on, both with their blessing and their prayers and their financial help. He wants them to send him on his mission endeavor, his church planting endeavor into Spain. And so he is wanting them, essentially, to know enough about him and his preaching and teaching so that they can invest in it, so that they can buy in to him and his ministry. So he is kind of recruiting them, essentially by telling them, this is what I believe and teach, so that they would have a comfort level of wanting to support him. So there's actually an application, and I'm not even done with the introduction yet, okay? But we need to pause for a moment for this application. Unity in the church and zeal for mission, for evangelistic mission, for church planting, come from a deep understanding and a full-hearted embrace of the truth of the gospel. Paul the apostle wants them to unify, and Paul the apostle wants to encourage outreach. And what does he do? He writes the most dense and the longest theological treatise in the New Testament. He does not do sort of a pep rally. Let's all just get along. He does not beat them over the head. You're supposed to be unified. You're supposed to be unified. What he does is he builds unity in this church brick by brick by brick by explaining to them the theological foundations of his gospel ministry. Too many people in our kind of shallow culture, too many people, even within the church, think that to experience unity, we need to water down the truth, kind of a lowest common denominator, and de-emphasize doctrine, but not Paul. Not Paul. He builds unity by strong and meaty truth being proclaimed. So, why don't we jump in and why don't we read? And you will see what I'm talking about when I refer to the book of Romans as being a dense theological treatise. So Romans chapter 1, verses 1 to 7. Romans 1, 1 to 7. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets and in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, who is descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ, our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you who were called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So this passage immediately introduces us to the author, Paul the Apostle. By the way, ordinarily in ancient Greek letters, someone would say their name, Rodney, to Community Bible Church and move right into the letter. But Paul the Apostle extends that for seven verses and packs in, really, a summary of the gospel itself. So he introduces us to himself. He is an apostle, which means that he is an authoritative representative of his Lord, of his master, of his king. He is an authoritative representative as an apostle. He was set apart. This is something that he was called to from the very beginning of his Christian experience. When he met the Lord Jesus Christ on the road, he was called to represent, as an authoritative representative, the gospel and Jesus himself to the Gentiles specifically. And then if you were to skip down to verse number 5, in verse number 5, he says, through whom we have received grace and apostleship. And that we is probably an editorial we. He probably just means himself individually and privately. Not necessarily all of the apostles, although they certainly, this is true of them, but he's probably talking about himself. Through whom we have received grace and apostleship. Or in other words, he's received grace, the power of God, like we talked about last week, to fulfill his apostolic calling. But the one thing that I skipped is the very first thing that he says about himself in verse number 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus. A servant of Christ Jesus. The primary way that Paul the Apostle saw himself was through the lens of servanthood. He was a servant, and a servant denotes, it is actually the Greek word for slave, or bond slave, or bond servant. But in at its most basic, it meant a slave, someone who was owned by another, who belonged to another, and did their bidding. It denotes absolute, total devotion. And so, all of his life was focused around Christ Jesus. He was owned by Christ Jesus. He was the servant. He was the slave of Christ Jesus. This is how he saw himself. This is how he organized all of his life around his master. I think an illustration of this from literature is Samwise Gamgee in The Lord of the Rings by J.R.R. Tolkien. He was a servant, was he not? He organized in that story. He organized all of his life. He carried all those pots and pans so that he could feed Frodo. Right? He did all of those things. He was a loyal servant, but he was also a faithful friend. And that gets at this idea of a bond servant, or even this Greek term for slave. In our service to Christ, being owned by him, him being literally our master, also carries with it the potential for communion, the potential for fellowship, the potential for friendship with God. Ordinarily, I have in my past not been interested in fellowshipping with my boss, right? They're my boss, and I do what they tell me to do. Right? There's kind of a distinction there. And there obviously is a distinction between us and our Savior, is there not? But we can also have a friendship with him. We can fellowship with Jesus Christ, who is both our Lord and our friend. And I think that Sam illustrates that. He was both a loyal servant and also a faithful friend. And we have the potential to fellowship with Jesus as our master. And then finally, the gospel, in this little introduction, the gospel is the heartbeat of the letter to the Romans. The gospel. And so he says this in verse number 1, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. Set apart for the gospel of God. Now, the entire book of Romans really is an exposition of the gospel of God. The good news of God's grace entering this world through the Lord Jesus Christ to save people from their sins for the glory of God. That good news is the heartbeat of the entire book of Romans. But I want you to notice some of the terms that he uses, starting in verse number 2, some of the terms that he uses to speak about the glory of this good news. So he, in verse number 2, says, which he promised beforehand, which he promised beforehand, through his prophets, in the Holy Scriptures concerning his son. And so I just simply want to point out that this is elevated language. This is language that stretches back into eternity because God has planned this redeeming good news since eternity past. And this is almost cosmic language. God is using prophets in the Scriptures and the Holy Spirit to inspire those prophets and Scriptures. And so we can learn from this that the gospel, the good news of God's saving grace, is not an afterthought. It is not an afterthought. And this really glorious language that he uses should remind us that it is something that we can dive into the depths of and never, never exhaust. You will not ever find the boundaries of the goodness and the graciousness of the gospel, of this news of God's saving grace in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as we continue to work down through this passage, I have three primary points. Again, a few little blanks that can help you in following along as you fill them in. But number one, as I've already alluded to, the center of the cosmic mission of God is Jesus. And I'm referring each of these points to the cosmic mission of God because of this elevated language that Paul has used to describe the gospel. So the center of the cosmic mission of God is Jesus. It is Jesus. So as we get down there to verse number 3, this gospel of God is concerning his Son. It is concerning his Son. And now Paul the Apostle, in very sort of dense and abbreviated language, describes the Son of God. He was descended from David according to the flesh. He was descended from David according to the flesh. And that phrase just reminds us of two things. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of David. Or as some people say, he is great David's greater son. Jesus is greater than his forebear David. He is a greater king. He is a greater shepherd than David. He is the messianic descendant of David, who was promised and prophesied and is a better David than David. Right? He's a better shepherd than David, a better worshiper than David. He is the ultimate. He is the better king than David. So he's descended from David. It emphasizes his messiahship, the promised coming Messiah. But it also emphasizes the weakness of his incarnation. It emphasizes, because of that phrase, according to the flesh. That word flesh is the word in the New Testament that very often has that negative connotation about our sinful nature. But Jesus didn't have a sinful nature. He had a human nature and experienced the weakness of existing in the flesh. And so he, in his humiliation of taking on flesh, bearing the burden of our sin in a very physical suffering, he experienced human weakness. And that is in contrast to the next phrase, which refers to, or the next clause, which refers to his resurrection. So he was descended from David according to the flesh, but verse number 4 was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. In other words, through the affirming power of the resurrection, he has been, it says here, declared to be the Son of God by the power of the Spirit. So the contrast is the weakness of his flesh, and then after his resurrection, he is in a demonstration of his power and divine glory and victory. Now there's a little problem. There's a little problem in this verse. The word declared more accurately should be translated appointed. That Jesus was appointed the Son of God in power at his resurrection. However, we don't ordinarily think, and the New Testament does not ordinarily teach, that Jesus was appointed the Son of God by his resurrection, as if he had not been the Son of God before. That's a particular heresy, actually, called adoptionism. That God kind of adopted Jesus to be his son after he had lived this sinless life, died, and so he raised him from the dead. That is not true, and that is not what this is saying. But you could be tempted to think that if you translated this word as it really should be, appointed. But it can also be understood as crowned. Jesus was crowned the Son of God in power. And really the contrast that's going here is Jesus came in weakness. He came in weakness, but he rose again and ascended to the very throne of God in power. in a demonstration of his divine power. There was a sense in which for Jesus to take on flesh and to appear in weakness, he had to veil part of his divine power. But that was fully revealed, and he was crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords at his resurrection and ascension. So again, Paul is not pulling any punches here. He is being honest about the incarnation and the weakness of our Lord Jesus here upon the earth, literally dying for us, but he is also speaking clearly and, as it were, cosmically about the power of Jesus in the resurrection and his victory. So, the center of this good news, this cosmic mission of God to save people from their sins, the center of that is concerning his Son, Jesus Christ. The purpose of the cosmic mission of God is, first of all, we find in verse number 5, we've already talked a little bit about the apostleship of Paul the apostle, but the second part of verse number 5, he says that they were given grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations. So the purpose of the cosmic mission of God is, first of all, worldwide. He mentions the nations. He talks about this being a good news that can bring about obedience of faith for the glory of God among all of the nations. So the purpose of God's cosmic mission is worldwide. God is not interested in just having one nation as his people. He is going to, by the end of, in the book of Revelation, we see there are going to be people gathered around the throne from every language and tribe and nation and people. And so this is among the various nations of the world, the people groups of the world, that he is working out his salvation. And then also, the purpose of God's mission is the obedience of faith. The purpose of God's mission is the obedience of faith. And this is not just the typical doctrinal explanation that if you believe in God, you will also follow Christ's commands. You will be obedient. That faith births obedience. That is true. That is true. A biblical truth. That is a New Testament truth. But what this is saying is that to believe in Jesus to begin with, to trust in Jesus Christ for your forgiveness of sins means that you have to stop trying to earn your own salvation and you have to obey God to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a command to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. And so just simply believing on the Lord Jesus Christ is an obedience itself to God. Because he has called us, he has commanded us to believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that faith being placed in Christ is in itself an obedience. And then that obedience and that submission to God, that surrender to him, of yielding myself to him, that just carries on throughout the rest of a Christian's life. And then the purpose of God's mission is also for the sake of his name. For the sake of his name. Everything. Everything. Every church planted, every gospel tract given, every Bible printed, everything, every time that you speak with your neighbor or friend about Jesus and his saving grace, everything is for the glory of God. It is for the sake of his name, that his name would be lifted in praise and worship, both now and throughout eternity. There, Revelation has these pictures, does it not, of the glorious heavenly worship of the people of God. It is for the sake of his name that God has saved his people. And then number three, the cosmic mission of God is personal. The cosmic mission of God is personal. One of the phrases that would be the easiest to overlook in this introduction would be the beginning of verse number 6, including you. Including you. Um, We know what it's like to be excluded, even if it's nothing more than a kickball game in the playground. We know what it's like to be excluded. And Paul the Apostle takes the time in these introductory verses to say, including you, including me, including you. To be included means also to be called to belong. Do you see that there? Including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints. And so this idea of calling in the New Testament is not just sort of an invitation, come if you want to. It is the powerful invitation of Almighty God, calling people from all over the world, throughout all of history, to be His own. It is not just a sort of come if you want to invitation. Of course, He's not like forcing us necessarily to believe. We believe. We come in brokenness and we come in faith. But this calling is powerful. It's the effectual calling, sometimes people call it, of God, where He works on the hearts of people to draw them to Himself. And this calling to belong and this calling to be saints, it flows out of His love to all those in Rome who are loved by God. Here's kind of the illustration that comes to my mind. The illustration that comes to my mind is a young family with a toddler or two. And when daddy comes in the front door, he calls their name, Johnny, Susie, come give daddy a hug. And all these little, fat rolls running down the hallway to just come and embrace their daddy, right? It would almost be impossible if they're young enough, it's almost impossible to imagine them not coming, right? Because of just the power of that relationship, the power of that call. Now, I know that it wears out somewhere at a certain age. It kind of wears out, and daddy coming home has to get a dog if he wants a greeting at the door, right? Because that they never outgrow that. I know that kids outgrow this thing, but nevertheless, you can imagine this with me. There's a power in that call. There's a power in that relationship. It's kind of irresistible. And that's what he's talking about here. Called to belong. And all of this good news, all of this gospel, the death and the burial of our Lord Jesus Christ, even before that, the promise beforehand concerning his Son, the prophets and the Holy Scriptures, the incarnation of the Son of God as the descendant, the messianic descendant of David, and then the death and the burial and the resurrection and the ascension and the exaltation of our Lord Jesus Christ. All of this amazing cosmic mission of God is so that we can belong to Jesus Christ. So that we can belong. And through this belonging to Him, His name can be glorified. Think about this. What are all the kinds of different things that humans can belong to? What do you belong to? A bunch of you guys belong to this church in literal, formal membership. And some of you don't yet, and you should. Right? You should belong to this church as literal, formal members. But, all right, tell me, what are some other things that you can belong to in this world? Unions. Yes, you can belong to a union. I expected that one to be said in our blue-collar congregation. What else can you belong to? You can also belong to management, right? But we won't talk about any of those tensions, right? God's building unity in our congregation. All right, I didn't intend to say that. What else can you belong to? 4-H Club. You can belong to 4-H Club. David, what can you belong to? Car clubs, that's right. Tom, you can belong to men's Bible study. You can belong to women's Bible study. What are other things that we can belong to? Quilting, your quilting circle. You can belong to a quilting circle. Nobody has said a team. You can belong to a team. You can belong to a family. But because we are broken in sin, we find ourselves again and again and again isolated, do we not? We find ourselves separated from one another. You belong to a marriage, but then sometimes there's a divorce. You belong to a family, but families become broken. You belong to a church, but sometimes there's church splits. We find ourselves isolated repeatedly. Fundamentally, because we are broken in sin, we experience isolation. We experience belonging at a human horizontal level, and we feel the blessing of that. We feel the encouragement of that. But then we go through a period of time when, again, we feel lonely. Maybe our spouse dies. Our children grow up and go away, leave home and start their own lives. And so we feel lonely again. And I will just say this, the more and more that within our culture the family breaks down and we forget how to do relationships, the more and more individually we feel isolated in this world. But God has called us to belong to something that is not going to ever break. He has called us to belong to Jesus, who is eternal and never fails and is always faithful. He has called us to belong to Christ. And that means He wants to restore us and who we are. In fact, you know what? We actually learn, as just children, we learn who we are. We learn our identity by belonging. We learn our identity by belonging. And if you belong to a healthy family, you sense safety in that family. You learn who you are by belonging. And so God wants to reteach us who we are. He wants to reteach us our identity in the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's a lot of that in the book of Romans. And God wants to include us in a family of Christ. That including you means you. So this passage asks us some questions. It asks us, do we care about the unity of the church? Do we care about the mission of the church? Do we share the gospel? Do we guard the unity of the church? Do we, like Paul, see ourselves as servants who can serve and fellowship at the same time? Have we experienced the obedience of faith? Have we said yes to salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ? Have we submitted and surrendered and yielded? And do we live in the richness of belonging to Jesus? Do we live in the richness of belonging to something and to someone greater and more faithful than ourselves and anything else upon this earth? The last part of verse 7 says, grace to you and peace. Grace to you and peace. You know, we all know what it's like to be gone from home, right? We all know what it's like to travel, maybe on the best vacation you can possibly experience. Maybe it's, you know, camping in the Grand Tetons, or maybe it's, you know, Disney in Orlando, right? It could be the greatest experience of a vacation, but we all know what it's like to come home, right? And there is this sense of relaxation and relief that we're home. We're home in our own bed, sitting in our own chair, around our own table, eating our own food, with our own people, coming home. Coming home to Jesus. We know what it's like to experience the grace and peace of literally coming home after a journey. The grace and peace of Jesus is what we experience when we come home and we belong to Him. Let's pray. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you. In your sovereign plan, you worked on the heart of Paul and the people in Rome to produce, through the Holy Spirit, this book, the letter to the Romans. And Lord, here, nearly 2,000 years later, We are learning from this book, and we are seeing the beauty of Jesus in this book in a fresh new way. And I pray that you would, even today, call some of our hearts, young or old, to belong to Jesus. Draw us near. Draw us to the glory and the grace of who he is, both in his weakness here on earth and in his power and glory in heaven, in his exaltation. And help us to always remember that if we belong to you, we belong. We will experience all the peace that our heart needs in Jesus. Amen. Well, worship team, why don't you come and lead us, especially now as we prepare our hearts to receive communion together. We're going to sing, Oh, the Wonderful Cross, kind of a fresh rendition of a hymn. And I want to encourage you to focus your hearts upon the sacrifice of our Lord during this time. Stand with me as we sing.
Thank you.
You may be seated, and I hope that you have your little communion kit there, and that you will remember our Lord Jesus and his sacrifice together with us. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his disciples together in the upper room. They had received the Passover together already. And then in addition to the celebration of the Jewish Passover, he began this Lord's table, or this communion service that we use to remember our Lord Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for us. He even on that night said, "Do this in remembrance of me." If you're a believer here today, if you, whether you're a member of our church or not, if you follow the Lord Jesus Christ, if you have trusted in him for the forgiveness of your sins, you are welcome to receive communion with us. And on that night, he took bread and broke it and blessed it and said to his disciples, "This is my body. Take eat." Oh Lord, we are grateful for the sacrifice of the body of our Savior for our sins. We know that Jesus was crushed for our iniquities. He was bruised for our sins. And so, Lord, we are thankful. We ask that you would help us to remember this sacrifice. As we look at our own lives, help us to live out of gratefulness for the sacrifice of our Savior. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I hope that you also can open your cup there. And Jesus also said to his disciples on that night that he took a cup, he shared it with his disciples, and he said to them, "This is my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink from it, all of you." O Lord Jesus, we are thankful for your willingness to literally bleed for us, your willingness to sacrifice your life under the condemnation of our sins so that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We ask, O God, that you would draw us again and again and again, our hearts and our memories, back to the cross. And as this song has sung, that we ourselves would die to our flesh, die to ourselves, take up our cross and follow Jesus. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior. Amen. Well, let me mention the benevolence offering as we always do on the first Sunday of the month. The plates are there for you, and it will especially this time go towards just the traveling expenses of our Life Action young people. I'll be around afterwards. If you would like to talk or pray with me about something, just speak to me as you go out, and I'll hang around as long as is needed. Go in the grace of the Lord. You're dismissed.